how we will work this today. Each candidate, we will have three rounds of questions. The first round will be 45 seconds to answer. At 15 seconds, our timer will put up a yellow card and let you know that's all you have left, and then you'll put up a red card when that one is done. Our second round will be 2 minutes with the same dynamic. And there's 15 seconds left. Our timer will let you know the red will stop. In our third round, you will have 1 minute to answer. And at 15 seconds, our timer will let you know, and then there will be a red to stop. Now we have something different, so listen carefully. You see, you have some paddles on your table. Victor, you have a green one. I think you have a black one there. And a blue, and you have a purple. Here's what these are for. If you have a rebuttal to someone's statement of a question, you may put up your paddle and let us know that you want to do a rebuttal. You can do this at any time throughout the entire forum. But I know you say,
well, the forum's never going to get that. No, sir.
What's going to happen, you have exactly 5 chances to rebut. If you use them in the first section, you're done. If you use them in the middle, so do this carefully, but you will have a chance to rebut if you need to. 5 and 5 only. With that said, okay. Oh, there he goes. Hello? There we go. Okay, thank you. I'd like to introduce our candidates for mayor. First, Victor Gordo, Pasadena council member and attorney. Next, Jason Harden, entrepreneur. Next, Terry Tornet, mayor of Pasadena. And next, Major Williams, businessman and marketeer. Also today, we have a few people who will be asking the questions. There are panelists who will be asking the questions. First, let me introduce James Farr, host and producer of The Conversation Live. We also have Bradley Bermont, Pasadena Star News City Hall reporter. Let's get it on. The first question will be from James Farr.
Good afternoon, candidates.
45 seconds, by the way. 45 seconds to answer.
Good afternoon, candidates. When Chief Washington was abruptly resigned, it raised more questions than answers for the community. Was this process handled correctly? And if not, what needs to happen going forward?
Fix this for me in a minute. But we'll start from left to right, starting with Victor, and we'll move from left to right. And the next question will start with the next person in line.
So one of the concerns with this situation is it involves personnel matters, potentially. And individuals in our city and most, if not all, public employees enjoy constitutional right to privacy. It's rooted in the Constitution, and so it's difficult to talk about for all of us that are members of the city council. But set that aside. The question is, process-wise, set aside the personnel issues and the rights of individuals. Should the process have been handled differently? Could it have been handled differently? Yes. I'm not at all pleased with how the process has proceeded.
Personally, I think the matter was handled improperly. What I would do about
experience to get to the bottom of actually what happened. Thank you.
Personnel matters, particularly those for firefighters and public safety officers, are very tightly regulated, and it's a dangerous thing for elected officials to meddle in that process, because I think the involvement of the political process in hiring and firing obligations need to be vested in the city manager and our form of government. Also, I think the rights of the individual have to be carefully protected, so I think that the process has not yet completed itself. I think to date it's probably been handled as best it could.
I would like to say that the handling of the case was, I personally feel like it was mishandled, but I do understand the procedural matter in regards to how they actually conduct business, and that's something that we have to revisit as leadership and as city council members, and also as a mayor. We have to look at the mechanisms that we have in place that allow these type of situations to continue to happen here in the city. So am I for it? No, I'm not for it. I'm against it. And always, when you're looking at how we do things here in Pasadena, there's always, in my personal opinion, ways that we could, I think from a policy standpoint, change the narrative on how we actually proceed forward. And until we change that, we will continue to be, continue this cycle.
Thank you.
We'll use all my time.
Okay, next question will come from Bradley Vermont.
Pasadena Unified is facing significant funding shortfalls and is closing campuses to try to cope. Despite being a distinct public body from the city council, should the city do more to help buoy its public schools, or considering the city's new sales tax measure, is it already doing enough?
We'll start, Mr. Harden. We're in a 45-second round, okay? 45-second round, and I will let you know when we change.
Honestly, I do think the city can do more. I think Measure J is long overdue. I think there should have been some stipulations between the city and the school district. I think there should have been some support there all along. But like I said before, I believe the support for our local schools does not start or end on council. If you're on council, I believe you're supposed to advocate for public schools outside of the job duties and get more folks from our private schools into our public schools. Thank you.
I have worked tirelessly to try to build bridges between the school district and the city. There's been traditional resistance and separation between the two entities because we have two separate elected bodies. But starting with 6 years ago, with Collaborate Pasadena and then moving into Measures I and J, I meet consistently with the school staff, with school board members. We have tried to build bridges at the staff level between the school district and the city so that there's an institutional relationship between those entities. Ultimately, it's really not about who has political jurisdiction. It's about serving our children. And so I think we have done more, and we will continue to do more as long as I'm there.
I believe that if you do not have a history of building bridges in order to foster great relationships and networks with either our community, with the citizens, or even the school district, it's going to continue to fall null and void in regards to bad decisions and us having frustrations that we're actually having now with our school versus with our city. Moving forward as an ex-mayor, I will look forward to bringing new and fresher ideals to work with our school board, so we can actually bring alignment to match the diversity and the affluency of our city. And it really just comes down to us not being able to connect with our school board versus with the mayor's office as well. So I look forward to that challenge and that opportunity. Thank you.
Mr. Gordon. So the history of working together goes back decades. I should remind people that it was in the early 2000s that we actually asked the PUSD to give up its police department, and we took on that charge as a city, and we turned dollars to the classroom. That was the right thing to do. We have a joint use agreement that was started first in Madison Elementary in my district to allow the schools to be used after school for recreation. When we discovered that a majority of the kids who attended Madison, I'm sorry, I'm not a majority, but a lot of kids who attend Madison were suffering from different health diseases, including diabetes. And now we're moving forward with early childhood education.
Should the city consider acquiring any campuses closed by the school district to turn them into affordable housing or for other community-based uses?
We'll start with Mr. Cornett.
Thank you. We are already in discussions with the school district on both the staff and board level about the reuse of campuses that have been surplused. I think housing is a logical use in several instances, both workforce housing for teachers and affordable housing for families. And I think that we're having receptive response from the district, and the planning department is hard at work trying to understand how to modify the zoning to accommodate those. So I think there's great opportunity in those campuses, represented by those campuses, in terms of generating both income and housing.
I believe there's a natural process when you have any kind of crisis in regards to affordable housing shortage here in the city. I feel like if the city is actually working on something right now, then the question begs to the expedition of it. When is it going to take place? And who do you have in place that's actually having these conversations with the school district in order to mediate that and expedite the process? What we've dealt with a lot here in the city is having, either the mayor's office butting heads because they can't have a decent conversation and get things done. And so I believe that we should work with the schools and refurbish some of those for the teachers, for the actual students, and for a lot of people here in the community. And that's what I would champion for as an ex-mayor of Pasadena. Thank you.
So I think this is a broader conversation. I think we have to be careful when we talk about disposing of school sites. You all recall the 7-Eleven committee, I think it was in 2007, that actually recommended against disposing of school sites. That's our infrastructure for providing schools in the future. And I'm very concerned about disposing of any properties that then sends the message that Pasadena has given up on public education for the future. 40 years from now, if we dispose of these properties, we'll never get them back. And so how are we going to provide public education going forward? And so we need to have that conversation. We should use some of the campuses in order to address the early childhood learning. Some of these campuses, you'll recall that a great deal, if not the majority of our kids, are not prepared to enter the PUSD to begin with. And so we need to address early childhood education. We could use some of these campuses to achieve that.
Thank you. Mr. Tornick, everyone will get a chance to respond, and then you will get a chance.
Thank you. I do see school closures as tragic, but I do also see them as opportunities. I do believe we should explore supportive housing, transitional housing, affordable housing, and take advantage of the opportunity we have. I also believe in school consolidation. I know that nobody wants to see their schools closed, but the truth is we do not have enough students to fill them, and that kind of weighs in on the resources that are available to the students we have. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Tornick. You have 30 seconds.
Thank you. Just on this issue of potential use of school sites, I sat through meeting after meeting at the school board looking at the demographic analyses and reviewing the data that they've been chewing on for a long time. The enrollments of the 30,000 plus are not coming back because demographic trends across California won't support it. And so the likelihood that we're going to wind up with more than 14,000 students in the next couple of decades makes it imperative, I think, that we make use of those sites. And there's so much excess capacity even with the remaining buildings that it would be foolish to sort of hold those in case. So I think we need to exploit that opportunity and build some housing on those sites.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, the next question will come from Mr. Vermont.
California's leaders have been at war with the Trump administration for years now on the issue of immigration. Many communities have declared themselves sanctuary cities in response to the White House's hardline border policies. Should Pasadena join them?
Mr. Williams.
politics, I believe that Pasadena really at the place where we are right now, we should really focus hyper on local politics. We support legal immigration. We support legality from any standpoint. And as the next mayor, I look forward to participating in anything that's legal. So if we are a sanctuary city, I wouldn't stand by that. But also, I don't think anyone up here should stand for it if they're trying to become the next mayor of Pasadena.
Mr. Gordon? So this question actually was grappled with by the city council not too long ago. And one of the issues that we struggled with is, what does it mean to be a sanctuary city? What would be different than what we're doing now? I myself am an immigrant who came to Pasadena at age 4, and so I understand well the need to protect our families. I understand well the issue of not working with the federal government to enforce immigration law, because that's the role of the federal government. Police resources in Pasadena should be used to address local issues. If we want to have that debate again, I welcome it. I think that's the way we should handle these issues. But do I support working with the federal government to enforce immigration law? No, I don't.
Thank you. Mr. Harden.
Well, as Mr. Gordo said, I definitely would like a clear explanation of what a sanctuary city is. But that being said, I do believe our city has already joined, because we don't enforce national immigration laws. We don't have immigration status when police stop individuals on the street. So I think we have already joined.
Thank you. Mr. Tony. Once California declared itself a sanctuary state, I think that this discussion about the sanctuary city status really became moot. We did discuss this at the council. I agree with the position that says that the critical issue to reassure our residents is that the police department will not act as ICE does. We don't cooperate, we don't turn people over, and I think that that is the appropriate condition for the city to operate under.
Thank you. Mr. Farr?
We have a transportation system that grows in scope and sophistication each year, but simply stated, not enough people are using it. What would you do to encourage more ridership?
Start with you, Mr. Gordo.
So, you know, the first thing we need to do in order to encourage people to ride the local buses is do a better job with the headways, make it convenient. People will use mass transit when it's reliable and it's convenient. And so I'm asking the staff to reassess both of those issues. But the other thing we need to do is work with the surrounding cities to connect local transit to the regional transit. And so we have to work with the other cities in the San Gabriel Valley, and we're not doing that right now. And so the second thing I would do is ensure that Pasadena is actually working with its neighbors to make our local transit and regional transit convenient and reliable.
Thank you. Mr. Harden.
First of all, I think Pasadena Transit has recently done a good job at rebranding itself as actual transit for the people. You know, they used to be the Arts Bus, and I know a lot of folks were confused with that that identification. But personally, if we're trying to get folks out of their cars and into public transportation, we have to lead by example. I know I ride the bus to this day. I have a tap card with money on it. I use ride share programs. I use light rail. And if the people on the city council aren't going to use it, then how can they tell anybody else to use public transportation? So we've got to lead by example, just like in anything else we do. Thank you.
I am a transit advocate. Once upon a time, I ran a regional transit authority, so I'm familiar with these activities. Pasadena Transit's ridership is up. It's celebrating its 25th anniversary. We've expanded routes and we've reintroduced Sunday service. We can do a better job. We do coordinate with Foothill Transit, which is the regional transit service. Marvin McAustin is our representative on the board, and I'm the alternate. So I think we have good cooperation and coordination with both Foothill and with Metro. But I do think we can and will do more. I agree that headway should be shortened. And now there's very active discussion at the state level, as you probably know, about free rides for students. I think that would be a huge change on passenger transit.
Thank you. Mr. Williams. I believe that if you you have to start promoting safety to get people out of their cars. More so, I think a lot of times when it comes to people wanting to get out of their cars and use some of the railways and the buses, is that they hear stories from their neighbors or from their family members in regards to the experience that they have. And so as a city, it's kind of like our job to work with our local staff to make sure that safety is intact so people can feel comfortable to actually get out of their cars and actually use the transit and the bus system that we have here in the city. Me personally, I am a fan of local transit. I don't use it as much as I possibly can, but I've seen a lot of great developments and also a lot of upgrades that have happened, and so it's something I would actively promote. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Gordon, you got him? 30 seconds.
So it's one thing to work with Metro and Foothill Transit, but shouldn't we be working with all of the cities around us? There are 31 municipalities in the San Gabriel Valley. 29 school districts, 2.3 million people. 30 of those cities are working to attract more transportation dollars, address traffic, work together as a region. Pasadena is the one city that's missing. I objected to it. It was pushed through, but we should be working with our neighbors. All of the cities in the San Gabriel Valley should be present, including the Crown of the Valley. And I intend to ask the council to change that. When our incumbent took us out, it was wrong, and it's wrong today.
Thank you. This ends the first round. Second round, each person will have 2 minutes to answer the question. 2 minutes to answer the question. Let's see, we will be starting with, we'll start with, I believe, Mr. Farr.
Should the city encourage churches to offer safe harbor parking for homeless people living in their vehicles? Should the city oversee such programs? Who else should participate in these programs?
We start with Mr. Gordo.
So I would be concerned. I think we should have a conversation, but I'd be concerned about the safety of the people living in their vehicles. You know, there are health implications involved. There are a lot of issues involved. What sort of infrastructure would the church provide in terms of restrooms? What sort of safety and security would be provided? What sort of services would be provided to individuals? Housing and homelessness is a serious issue, and that may be one way to address it, but I think it's a lot more complicated than just opening up a parking lot.
Mr. Harden.
I do believe that churches should participate if they would like to. I believe any company, any institution that has a parking lot should participate, because the truth is, the city says, and they pride themselves on homeless counts being lower, but I don't think that's an accurate number. I think that outlawing homeless people and outlawing people living in their cars has contributed to that lower number. I think outlawing recycling centers have contributed to lowering that number. So I think they're going about the homeless issue the wrong way. So absolutely, we should have safe harbors for people living in their vehicles, and we should be mindful of also safety issues. But that comes with actually caring about them. If we outlaw parking anywhere and homeless people in their cars anywhere, then what is the city going to do to care about them once they're in the parking lot? So we just have to address homelessness as a whole and not treat homeless people like criminals. Thank you.
Mr. Cornick.
Thank you. The larger discussion with the churches that we've been having have to do with providing permanent supportive housing on church campuses. But I do think that we've got such a crisis situation that we should consider the idea of safe harbor parking at churches, and we have a mechanism in the temporary conditional use permit to do that. It's interesting that PCC was confronted with a challenge at the state level where they were trying to mandate safe harbor parking at community colleges. PCC didn't take a position and sort of didn't like it, but they didn't really want to speak out. But in fact, they are permitting it in their parking structures on a de facto basis. So I think there is room to make some changes and use the vehicle of the temporary conditional use permit to make it possible in some church locations.
I believe this is a great topic and something I've been thinking about for the last couple of weeks because it has come up in a few groups that I have met with recently. And one of the things that I said is that I would probably support something kind of similar to like a two-year term. You know, with my background as far as in marketing, I like to test things in trials. I don't like to live off fear and the what if, you know, and what if this doesn't happen or what if this happens. I think that the crisis that we're in right now, we have to be innovative. We have to think out the box. And I would propose something like a two-year term in whatever safe space that we dedicate. And just to pull some analytics and data in regards to the experience of the people who are actually living in their cars in those areas, so we can truly make a better decision as a community, as a council. That way we can make a better choice to know if we want to continue to do it or just deem that as something that's considered as unsafe. Thank you.
Clearly, the homeless issue is too complex for only one program to solve. During your 2 minutes, share your ideas. As mayor, how can you lead the way to ease the homelessness crisis? And panelists, please be specific.
Start with you, Jason. Well, the first thing I would do is I would push for the establishment of an affordable housing commission. There are a lot of opportunities, a lot of policies that can be changed and created to alleviate the homelessness and also the displacement of folks who just can't afford rent in Pasadena. But those dialogues need to be happening on a consistent basis, and I believe an affordable housing commission can do that. I'm very supportive of vacancy taxes, of using church land to create affordable housing. I'm supportive of the Vermonter Inn transitioning into supportive housing and other motels transitioning to supportive housing. I'm also for ADUs and more ADUs in our neighborhood. I don't think they're going to be a threat to single family homes. And I just think we have to be very aggressive on the issue because one thing I don't want to see is shanties in our city. And I think we've done a good job at kind of controlling that, but they're coming if we don't do something fast. Thank you.
Some of the ideas with regard to providing housing and intervening in the homeless process and the homeless condition have already been discussed. I've been focused on city-owned properties, those that we control, and raised the urge my colleagues to move on providing permanent supportive housing in the Civic Center as part of the YWCA restoration project. We talked already about the use of school properties for affordable housing. I think that's a great opportunity. And we've also talked briefly about the church properties. There are a lot of churches, particularly in Northwest Pasadena, but not exclusively, that have surplus property that are considering downsizing in terms of their sanctuaries. And we've actually begun to have technical discussions with some of them about how they could build an affordable housing project, maintain a community room as a place of worship, so that they could maintain continuity of the church, but they may not need a sanctuary as grand as this in order to continue their presence and really contribute to the social welfare of the community. Beyond that, we have taken specific steps in terms of including raising our inclusionary housing percentage to 20% so that any project in the city now must have 20% affordable units. And we've raised the in-lieu fee so that it's not an easy out for developers not to build the units on site. We've also passed the hotel conversion ordinance, the motel conversion ordinance, which I took from my experience on Link Housing, which is a non-profit affordable housing developer statewide that's been used to advantage. I'm optimistic about the outcome of that opportunity. And I think we've heard a lot of discussion, and we already have some experience with temporary interventions with people before they fall into homelessness. It's a lot easier to keep people from becoming homeless than to then provide housing for them once they become homeless. And some very modest payments can help in that regard, and we've allocated funds to that.
So I'm surprised the mayor was able to give you 2 minutes of what he's been working on as if this is an issue that just started here in Pasadena. That continues to surprise me when we sit up here and we have these professionals, and they're talking to you in a sense that saying that they have all these plans and what they voted for, but yet this is not a new issue, Pasadena.
This is not a new issue. So all these plans and who you're working with and who you've been talking to, at what point do you get something done? So we're not at this point right now during another election cycle waving a flag in regards to this is what we're going to do. We have to do better, and it has to start with new leadership that actually get things done. So I think that for a fact that we should look at the 710 freeway, the 710 freeway stuff to bring affordable housing in that particular area. I also think that we should amend Measure I and J, which is $21 million a year. We should take $1 million out of that year, out of that money for 1 year, and start restructuring that back into the actual city. I have a plan to use $1 million a year that's going to go to rent stimulus for families that are unjustly evicted or on the cusp of being evicted. We have to begin to get creative, and the creativity only comes when you have someone that has a track record of being creative and getting things done. And so I also was talking about churches and synagogues who actually want to champion to use excess land to get to build affordable housing, to be areas sanctioned for safe harbor parking as well. So all these ideals that we're proposing, not only myself but anyone up here today, these are all ideals. I want to get past the ideals of talking about these things and finally get to the point where we are championing and cheering and congratulating each other because we actually started accomplishing something and decreasing the homeless community statistics here in the city. I'm up here not just to win the election. I'm up here to have a real conversation and to call everyone out because we're hearing the same type of rhetoric every single time that we're on these panels. I've been on this panel just 7 or 8 panels that we've had. We have to do better. Thank you.
Mr. Gordon. So homelessness and housing are interwoven. They're two issues that we need to address together. With regard to the issue of housing, I was on the council. I'm the only person on the stage who was on the council when it was actually controversial to go forward with an inclusionary housing ordinance. And I recall that, and we did the right thing. We need to also retain existing affordable housing. I did that at 1070 North Lake when Margaret McCrossman came to me and said, these units, 114 units of senior housing are going to go to market. Will you help me out? I did. I stepped in and I helped Margaret and McCrossman and her neighbors retain that affordable housing with a loan of about $550,000, $580,000 or so to the property owner to improve it. And we need to do more of that. 6 of the last 7 affordable housing projects that were built in the city of Pasadena have been in my, that where the city participated, have been in my city council district, and we've been creative about it. We've gotten rid of liquor stores and replaced them with affordable housing. We're the only council district to do that. We've improved burned out buildings on Hudson, as an example, near Washington, and created a permanent supportive housing for seniors. We've done that work and we need to do more of it. We also need to prevent people from falling into homelessness, and we have those programs that we need to make it better known. And then finally, a lot of the people who are homeless today suffer from addiction and or mental health disorders or dual diagnosis, both. And we need the press, and I've asked that this matter be agendized and bring the County of Los Angeles in to ask the question, how are you serving the people who are homeless in this community? What are you doing about addiction issues? What are you doing about mental health issues? And we need to be more forceful about that. And again, working with our neighbors in the San Gabriel Valley. When my opponent was asked about leaving the San Gabriel Valley.
That's time.
Sorry. Yes, and we have one rebuttal. We have 30 seconds. Mr. Tornier.
I just wanted to make it clear that we haven't just been about ideas. We've been taking serious action on the homeless front. And that's why Pasadena is one of only 2 of the 88 cities in the county that's had a reduction in homelessness. We've moved hundreds of people off the street. We made the YMCA into an SRO that's serviced by friends by Union Station and provides services to more than 100 formerly homeless people. This is not just about ideas. We've allocated $1 million to the Salvation Army to build 66 units on their campus on Mentor. So it's not just conversation that's been happening here. It's real action. And while the problem, there's a lot more to be done, and while the problem is very daunting, we've been acting on it and having some success.
So that's right. The Salvation Army project, 64 new units, is actually in my district as well. But think about homelessness. The people who are homeless move around the region. We have to work together as a region. When my opponent, when the incumbent mayor was asked why he pushed to leave the San Gabriel Council of Governments when homelessness and housing are regional issues, the answer was those cities are smaller than us. They're not relevant. I reject that. Pasadena is not going to solve any of these issues, homelessness, housing, traffic alone. We need to get back to working with our neighbors who are working together to attract federal and regional dollars.
That's time. Okay. We're going to move on here, and next question comes from Mr. Farr.
Effective January 1st, California enacted the Tenant Protection Act aimed at preventing egregious rent increases for residents, but it does not include some limits. Does Assembly Bill 1482 provide sufficient protection to renters in Pasadena, or should the city take additional steps?
We start with Mr. Pointing.
Pasadena has its own tenant protection provisions, and we just strengthened them a couple of months ago to begin to reflect the fact that there were some loopholes. I do support 1482 in terms of having a cap in terms of the maximum amount that rent can be increased in any given year. What I do not support is rent control. There's been some strong advocacy in the city for those that believe that rent control is what we need and what we should have. My specific experience, my life experience with rent control growing up in New York, and also every study that I've read of any value has demonstrated that rent control is a feel-good thing that actually destroys housing. It does that because it prevents people from investing in existing housing because they can't realize a return, and it discourages investment in new housing, which we need in order to increase the housing supply. So when we begin to talk about strengthening, we will continue to modify and fill gaps in terms of what we do on our own tenant protection ordinance. If there is a campaign of signatures are collected and we have a rent control campaign, I will actively oppose it. But I think we do need to continue in terms of the context of the rest of the discussion to do everything we can to build additional affordable housing, particularly family housing, and we've already identified ways in which we can do that.
I believe if we are very serious about building more affordable housing, we're going to mediate the conversation about rent control. I, too, haven't been an advocate for rent control, but I do believe in fairness when it comes to landlords unjustly evicting tenants from their homes. I do support the Pasadena tenant protection that we have here in the city, but I do, like anything, I feel like there can be evolution. There can be more input. That's something else that we can add to it in regards to making sure that it's stronger. And just make sure they make sense for Pasadena currently today. Oftentimes, we get caught up in what these ordinances were based upon the ideology of someone who still thinks it's 10 or 20 years ago. It's really about where we are currently today, and then also having the know-it-all and the want to actually get the opinion from the actual community. I think we don't source the community enough because we have so many great minds just in our neighborhoods and our communities right next door to us that have better ideas than some of the city council members that I've heard over the last 10 years being here. So it really just comes down to understanding what we have and understand that it's okay to add to it and know that we can evolve when it comes to policy and protection for our residents and tenants that are, you know, advocating and fighting for tenant protections. So as the next mayor, I would support what we have, but also I would support evolving it. I also support 1482 as well, the act. Thank you.
So we do have a tenant protection ordinance in place, and I've supported it, and I think it's important for people to be treated fairly. I think what we've seen, what we saw last year as an example at South Madison, when a couple of landlords decided at the urging of an attorney to try and get ahead of the change in state law was disgraceful. And when those tenants came to city council and were told initially the role of the city has no role to play, I rejected that. And I insisted at the city council meeting that the staff meet with the tenants to push back and enforce our tenant protection ordinance. So I think we need to monitor our tenant protection ordinance. I think we need to also put some teeth in the tenant protection ordinance in terms of enforcement, and then we need to get into enforcing the ordinance. That was one of a few examples where a few landlords were not being fair, were trying to skirt around the law, and I believe also our tenant protection ordinance. And so enforcement is going to be the key. Monitoring to see if there needs to be adjustments is going to be the key. And then also being active in the statewide discussion is also very, very important.
First off, I agree with the mayor and Councilman Goyle that we should strengthen our tenant protection ordinance, keep it strong, and definitely enforce it. But I'm for rent control. I don't see it as a solution to everything, but I do see it as a preventative measure, because if the next 20 years play out like the last 20 years, a lot of us are going to become homeless. Thank you.
As Mr. Gordo just said, this is a perfect example of what city council members do and people in leadership do. When they're talking to you, they're talking about it should have more teeth. I believe that, you know, the gentleman said when he asked the question, be more, explain what that actually means. I think me as a resident, I'm tired of hearing that it needs more teeth or it needs more work. You as a leader, what is your creativity? What are you going to bring to the actual table? Can you describe what that is? What does that mean, more teeth to it? We need leadership that's actually going to be willing to step out and actually describe to you what that teeth would mean and how that would help you as a resident. Thank you.
Critics say the city's process to implement legal cannabis sales has been something of a tangle. As mayor, what steps would you take to ease the complications and speed a fair, equitable system into place? Do the current entanglements call for a do-over, or is clarity just a few weeks away?
Start with Mr. Williams. He didn't hear the question.
I'll repeat the whole thing. Critics say the city's process to implement legal cannabis sales has been something of a tangle. As mayor, what steps would you take to ease the complications and speed a fair, equitable system into place? Do the current entanglements call for a do-over, or is clarity just a few weeks away?
I think at this point right now there possibly could be a do-over. I reject the fact that you have 9,100 citizens who signed a petition in effort to get it on the ballot, and now you have the city suing itself with the support of the mayor and the city council members. A do-over may be possible, but I think it has to be just and fair, and it has to be a socioeconomic variable added into it. And it has to be, we were talking about this yesterday. I really think that we dropped the ball in regards to that, because we basically just said that, you know, we don't care about the democratic process. We can go and do the work in regards to saying this is what you're supposed to do in order to get things done here in the city. But then we're going to slap you back down because you accomplished what we didn't think that you were going to accomplish. So in regards to the cannabis being here in the city, I think that we should allow local shops to actually exist. There still has to be parameters. There still has to be restrictions. And we have to do it with care and dignity as well. But we can't allow big corporations to come in and just push everyone out who's actually been existing here. If they're small businesses or not operating properly, they should be shut down. But at the same time, as leadership, we should implement something that could actually give them the right structure, but the same structure that you feel like these big corporations would have. Give them that same training. Give them that same structure so they can exist, so they can thrive and take advantage of this cannabis industry that's going to be worth over $80 billion in the next 4 years if we do it correctly right here in the city. And those funds can be refurbished and reused for 100% affordable housing projects here in Pasadena for our struggling families. And I think it's important that we understand that we have to really look out and protect local people here in Pasadena versus always, jumping ship and allowing big corporations in regards to this particular topic to come in and just manifest. So I would support local cannabis shops, but it would have to be done in the right way. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Gordo. So I support the lawful sale of cannabis. Pasadenans have voted for it. The state has voted for it. It's the law of the land. And from the beginning, I've argued for a fair, transparent, and equitable process. And you'll recall when there were unlawful or operators who weren't following the rules, I demanded a fair, open, and transparent process and paid a pretty heavy price for it as others sat quiet. They actually came after me. Some of you will recall, but I did the principal thing and I continued to argue for a fair, open, lawful process. The current process is a mess, and I've been very critical of it together with Vice Mayor Hampton because it is a mess. The argument that we may have not complied with our own rules in the evaluation process, but we substantially complied. We're not a city that substantially complies. We're a city that complies with our own rules. I'm not convinced that we complied with the process that we set out. And as a result, I'm not convinced that it's been a fair and equitable process. I've said that publicly at City Council, and I'm going to continue to say it until we have, and I've asked when some of these issues surfaced, I went to the city manager and to the city attorney, and I said, I want these issues brought to ground, and I'm not convinced that they have been fully explored. I'm not convinced that the process that we have followed has been fair to all, and we need to assure ourselves that we didn't just substantially comply, that we did comply. And if we didn't comply with our own rules and our own process, then the matter should be brought to the City Council for reconsideration.
Personally, I feel the process of distribution of legal cannabis has been flawed from jump. I do believe that it's not fair, it's not inclusive, and that the families damaged by the enforcement of the law are still victimized, and we need to be mindful of how we can kind of create a system that makes it fair. And I totally supported Vice Mayor Hampton's call for a redo, if that's what you want to call it, because it's necessary. But sometimes I really feel that he doesn't have the support on council to make that happen. And if this is going to be the case, if this is going to be the process, I urge for the process to be much more expensive. I want Pasadena to be the most expensive place to run a legal cannabis business if we're only going to let rich folks take part in this business. Thank you.
I think that people in Pasadena are really divided about whether having legal sale of cannabis is even a good idea. But we went to the voters, they voted on it twice, and in each case we were instructed to in fact have a limited number of outlets in the city, and so I think we need to comply with the will of the voters, and the fact is that we tried prohibition, it didn't work. We've had 34 illegal dispensaries in Pasadena, all but one are now shut down, so we see that we need to have some legal distribution. So we created a very tough process and one that was very limited. And because the number of outlets was limited to 6 at a maximum and more likely 5 or 4, it was inevitable because of the potential profits involved that they would wind up suing each other and suing us and fly-specking it and going through a process to make everybody crazy. And frankly, we spent way too much time, I think, on an issue that for most people in Pasadena is not in the top 10 of most important things that the city faces. We've had a complicated process. Administratively, it probably could have been handled better. In my observation, cities around the state have all struggled with this because of the contentious nature of the process. So I think that we've had 2 independent investigations about alleged improprieties in the process, and they both come back negative. I think to do a do-over now would be a huge mistake because I think what we've been involved with is a whole new set of accusations and litigation. I think the best thing we can do is get the 2 or 3 open that have already been approved, gain some experience in terms of how they operate, and then determine whether we should modify the ordinance. So I'm not in favor of doing it over. I think the staff has made an honest effort. I think it's been an imperfect process, but frankly, given the conditions, I think that was inevitable.
Clarification. I believe it's been 1 investigation and then a review of the investigation, not 2 investigations into the process.
Oh, thank you, Randy. Mr. Farr, this is the last question in the 2-minute round.
Some critics say that the biggest problem with the methods Pasadena has used to install legal cannabis is that officials have turned their backs on the concepts of proper social equity and diversity, taking into consideration the legacy of cannabis sales, consumption, prosecution in California. Do you agree with this criticism? What steps would you take to set social equity in motion?
Start with you, Mr. Bruno.
So one of the reasons to proceed with the, giving effect to state law is to try and take, by legalizing it, take the criminal activity, take, you know, some of the violent activity out of our communities by legalizing cannabis. And I do think we missed the mark on the social equity issue at the onset. And if we go back and review, you know, you've now heard it yourself, you know, it could have been handled better. That's not the issue. The issue is not, could the issue of cannabis have been handled better? The question is, did the city follow its own rules? It's not a matter of handling. And so if the quote-unquote investigation did not look at all of these issues. It looked at a very narrow number of issues, and I believe looked at it from a liability point of view, not a real inquiry. I don't have confidence that what I've been shown answered the questions properly or even asked the questions. And so we need to revisit that issue, assure ourselves the people of Pasadena have a right to a fair and transparent process. And as we do that, we need to ask ourselves whether there's a better way to address the social equity issue, because we did miss the mark and we just need to admit that.
Personally, I feel the only way that we can, I guess, create any type of fairness is to redo the whole process. It's like the mayor said, I know that opens the door to a lot of litigation, a lot of issues, but that's the only way it can really be done. It's the only way it can really be fair. Other than that, like I said, I would try to make it the most expensive place to create a cannabis industry, because, like I said, the money would actually go towards economic development in those that were affected most, in the black populations that were affected most by the legislation before. So the only way we can do it is, like I said, if we don't start the process over, we got to charge more money. And we want to charge a lot more money, because it's a big business. It's a big business. And if the city's not gaining from it, and if the people aren't gaining from it, then it's a bigger problem than it's worth. Thank you.
The beginning of this process, I attended the early going at the convention center. There was such a response in terms of potential interest that we actually had this giant meeting at the convention center for potential applicants. It was really extraordinary. And we went through a whole discussion at the council and publicly about what the criteria should be for selection of potential vendors, of the six maximum vendors we should have. And the city opted for making sure that the vendors that we would have would be adequately capitalized so that they could make certain that the public safety issues in terms of security, that the physical build-outs, that they would be adequate and not degrade the neighborhood, the testing to make sure that the products were safe and they were labeled correctly. We wanted to make sure that we had first-rate operators, a limited number of operators, but they would be first-class operators. That created a certain amount of tension in terms of the social equity issues, and so we had a whole social equity component, which, in fact, I remember Martin Gordon was actively involved in arguing about, and modified that portion of the criteria to make sure that there was a social equity component to all of the proposers. We went as far as we thought we could go in terms of making sure that we had safe and capable operators. And in fact, if you look at what's happened in other communities like Los Angeles, where the social equity component was given a lot of emphasis, it's been a catastrophe. And people have been bankrupted and made promises that the city couldn't keep. The social equity component is one of those things that's nice to talk about, but if not managed correctly, can really be a disaster. So I think that I would be reluctant to redo the sort of weighting in terms of how that goes. And frankly, I'm amazed that we've got two questions on the cannabis issue and not more on homelessness and transportation?
So I believe the process, it's probably a sound process, but I'm going to be honest with you. Even for me to be talking about a cannabis issue, not really knowing the nuances or the behind the scenes from a city council or mayor standpoint, I feel like I'm at a bit of a disadvantage. I've been running for an entire year talking to the actual residents. I haven't been sitting down mulling over the nuances of the cannabis issue. And I don't feel like I should have been because, like I said, from my experience talking to the community, that hasn't been a top issue or concern amongst the actual community. And so what I would say is I would focus on the social equity aspect of it. Anytime we have an opportunity to get an influx of revenue and funds, given the fact that we are where we are right now, those funds will absolutely go towards our homeless population in regards to building mental health facilities, drug facilities with wraparound services, and also focusing those funds that are captured on affordable housing, using some of the properties that the city owns and refurbishing and reimagining what those properties could be, and making sure we expedite the process. And so I too am a little offbeat in regards to giving these type of questions, because you have to understand, as a new candidate, as a new politician, some of these questions are really not tailor-made for someone like us or myself personally to answer. I'm not behind the scenes. I don't know what the meeting that the mayor has had or the city council members have had, but what I have done is talk to you. I've showed up at your doors. I've showed up at your community meetings. I've met with you at Starbucks. I allow you to text me. I get 100 text messages a day from local residents and talking to you and hearing your plights and your concerns. And not once, probably a couple of times, but was that a key issue or a topic that you truly cared about? You cared about your public schools. You cared about the safety in your community. And you cared about homelessness. Those are the issues that we need to focus on. And those are the things that I came here fired up today to talk about, in addition to Chief Patrell Washington being fired unjustly. Thank you.
Thanks, Connie. That was our last question of our two-minute round. We will now move into our one-minute round. I'm sorry, did I miss you?
Did I miss you?
No, you looked at me like, let me talk. I was like, let me back off. We're moving into our one-minute round. And the first question will come from Mr. Vermont.
Pasadena's police department has encountered recent challenges, including litigation, settlements, and rough patches in community police relations. Would civilian oversight of the police be a good idea? If so, and you played a role in implementing an approach, what would it look like? If not, why?
We start with you, Ms. Harden.
First of all, I don't want anybody to think I don't believe in policing, because public safety is, like I said, it's the most important thing to me, because this is my second time running and doing both campaigns. A friend of mine was shot in the middle of the campaign. Last time it was Josh Jacob. This time it was my circulator, Jasmine Richards. So when it comes to public safety, I do take it seriously, even though I do believe that we need a stronger oversight. We need oversight, period. We need complete reformation of our police department. We need to cut PPD spending and put it into the Vision 2020 initiative to create preventative measures. But yes, if I had to say what the oversight would look like, it would look like passing a police commission. The commission would have the rights as the new measure R would give the oversight to the sheriff. We would be able to subpoena. We would be able to call in evidence. We would be able to call in witnesses. And I do believe that we should be able to fire and terminate some folks that just abuse their power. Thank you.
Thank you. As far as most people are concerned in the city, public safety is the number one issue and what they are most concerned about city government doing effectively. And that's why we spend nearly half our general fund budget on public safety, and the number one department that we spend money on, $82 million, is the police department. The Public Safety Committee, which I serve on, is the oversight for that department. And I think that is having elected officials in that role is entirely appropriate. I was originally much more interested in having what they call a civilian oversight component outside of the city council. But as I began to look at the various models, I've seen that many of them, for a variety of reasons, have not lived up to expectations. So I think the department is doing a good job. I think use of force is way down. We have 6,300 arrests a year and 34 uses of force. The body-worn cameras have made a huge difference in terms of the police department culture, and so I don't think at this time that I would support an additional civilian oversight component.
I've gone on record saying that I would support a form of police oversight. One of the main reasons I said a form of, because I wanted to understand what they would actually look like, the mechanisms of it, and how it would be impactful and how it would be implemented and who would be a part of that role. Would it be elected officials or would it be actual citizens in the community? One of the things I was talking about creatively the other day is that, you know, if the citizens want to be a part of an oversight committee, you may have to go through the same rigors as what we're doing right here today. Let's come up with a committee and let's vote for a actual oversight committee, and then your community will actually vote for you to be a part of that community. Because if you want to do it, we want to have people that are committed citizens in the community, that are trustworthy, that or have a track record of making good decisions. If not, then it leaves us subject to questioning our police chief, our police department, which they have done a really good job in certain areas. In like any industry, any city, you know, any job, there's always improvements that we can make. But I would support a form of police oversight. Thank you.
So public safety is the most important issue that any city grapples with, because it involves two very important things. One, the safety and security of our residents in our city and our neighborhoods, our homes. But it also involves force against its own residents, potentially. And we should be very careful. I've been very consistent in my position. In fact, I've not changed my position from one side to another during the election or before that. I've said that I support strong police oversight by people who are elected and accountable to the voters of this city, the residents of this city. I see what happens in Los Angeles. I see, you know, the Mayor Garcetti and others say, you know, go talk to the police commission when they're approached by a resident. And then the police commission sits there like this because they're not accountable to the voters and they're not responsive. If we need to strengthen the public safety committee now that we've seen some changes in state law, then we should do that to give more transparency now that the law has changed.
You're asking next in line to speak, so you'll be able to speak your time and have 30 more seconds. Do you understand? Since you wanted a rebuttal?
Yes, I wanted a
correct.
Rebuttal.
Correct. You're next in line. So you're going to be able to say what you need to say, plus have an extra 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
I started the statement.
Oh, did you start?
Yes.
I'm sorry, Mr. Hardy.
No problem at all. No problem at all.
Oh, my goodness. You got me going, don't you?
No problem. Yeah. I just want to address one thing, and it's because the mayor says that of like 6,300 stops, there's only 30 uses of force, and that sounds like a very impressive number. But my question would be, out of those 30 uses of force, how many of those people were black or brown? And I ask that because if those 30 uses of force and that high percentage belongs to us, the black or brown community, then what does that say? Thank you.
Okay, next question will be coming from Mr. Carr.
Like most cities, Pasadena has paid out its share of expenses for legal costs and settlements related to allegations against its police department. Has the city paid too much? Or is this simply the cost of engaging in law enforcement during these sometimes volatile times?
Scott, would you just point?
The city has paid significant dollars in settlements. And frankly, in reviewing some of those cases, the city council was reluctant to, in fact, agree to some of those large settlements. But I think it is, unfortunately, given the reaction of the public and the jury system to police cases, and viewing the city as a kind of an ATM in many cases, not recognizing that the money comes from the people. The city is not some abstraction. If a big payment is made by the city, it's coming from the taxpayers, and it means it's money not being spent on programs for children and other kinds of things. So that we make these settlements because they have to be good business decisions, I think that a certain number of them are inevitable. We're working very hard with the chief. His whole training regimen is devoted to reducing use of force so that we won't have these kinds of settlements in the future.
I mean, just looking at the optics of it, I would say, of course, anytime you have to pay out from the taxpayers is too much. It really comes down to making sure that leadership is in tune with the police department, the chief of the police department, and just making sure that the proper protocols are being put in place in regards to training, but also evolving their training as well, and making sure that the officers out there conducting themselves in a professional manner. And I also think that we can try to alleviate some of those issues if we start hiring locally and grooming our young kids and our young adults and our teens and our, to want to participate in the police community, because I think we work better when we actually are familiar with the people that are policing and patrolling our area. And so, yes, we have paid out too much, and as the next mayor, it's something I would be very active on to keep active eyes on those situations so we can make sure that we mediate that. Thanks.
So besides being a very important issue, as I mentioned previously, policing is, it's also a very complicated and complex issue, requiring that the city hire the very best and train them to be fair, to respond appropriately when they have to respond in split seconds, and we press for that. I've been very unhappy with the cost of litigation and some of the payouts, but the city council has had to make business decisions in those situations, and we've done that. But let's keep in mind that it wasn't too long ago that we were arguing that recruiting the best and retaining the best and most experienced meant that we had to pay officers more. That was rejected by some on the city council. And then we lost a number of officers to other areas like Anaheim, Beverly Hills, Santa Monica, who were paying more. We were under 50% of the market. So we have to keep that in mind as well.
Well, quickly, I have a two-part answer. One, I do think the city plays a lot out in settlements. I do think that our police department, though they're heavily funded, they are the biggest liability in our city. I also feel that on the flip side of it, I see the people that are affected by the police killings. I see JR's children in the community. I've seen Chris Blue in the neighborhood. And the sad thing is it's not too much. When it comes down to it, life is priceless. So are we paying too much for the people that we snuffed out? No, we're not. But what I think the solution should be is if the police are training these officers well, then it should be a personal liability for these officers. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Vermont?
The Rose Bowl is perhaps the city's most beloved and enduring icon, but it is saddled with more than $200 million in debt following a delayed over-budget renovation. Inglewood's SoFi Stadium will soon offer another newer, higher-tech competitor for sports and concerts, and the Bulls' neighbors will continue to oppose additional events each year. What should be done to assure the historic stadium's fiscal viability for years to come?
We're starting with you, Mr. Mayor.
So I think it's an interesting challenge that me personally I would be excited about because it's an opportunity to take a historic, iconic landmark like the Rose Bowl. For me, you have to get excited about what you can use it for in regards to generating revenue. This is a place it's known globally. And so creating revenue for an actual space shouldn't be the most difficult task. And I don't think it's as of a complex issue as some may say or think that it is. I just think it comes to finding the right kind of partnerships businesses that we can bring on board to actually rejuvenate it and work towards getting that $200 million debt off of our books. And it also comes, the second part of it is making sure that we have the right kind of leadership on those commissions or part of that particular of the staff that's working with the Rose Bowl commissions and the committees. There's
huge opportunity. So what I would do is I would work with someone like, you know, I had a great idea for that. All right, so yes, I think it's something that's easy to do. We can find some really great partnerships to alleviate the debt. Thank you.
Mr. Gordon.
Easy to do, but let me say that the Rose Bowl, first off, the Rose Bowl is not subsidized by the city. The convention center is subsidized to the tune of $13 to $14 million a year. We did the right thing in renovating the stadium and preparing it for competition. We got ahead of it. In 2007, when I was sent over to the Rose Bowl operating company, our total revenues were just over $12 million, gross revenues. Today, they're over $56 million. And we've done it responsibly. We've done it responsibly by investing in the stadium and preparing it for competition. And some of the neighbors recognize that. I'm very proud to have the support of people like Nina Chomsky, who once called for my resignation from the City Council and the RBOC. And so we should be proud of what we've done. But it's a concern. I mean, who can tell me who's going to be touring next year? You can't. Who can tell me how UCLA is going to perform every time 10,000 people don't show up? We lose $500,000.
That's fine.
We lose the fan base.
Well, one thing we can do, I believe, to get out of that debt with the Rose Bowl is reassess how many major events we have in a year. You know, I know that a lot of people wanted to limit them to, I think it's 12 or 13 right now, but in the spirit of economic development and also the addressing debt, we do have to explore if more events would be feasible and would be actually a benefit. And then another thing I think that we missed in an opportunity is the renaming of the field. I think the Spikler Field deal, I think that was way... A very low ball number. I think he paid $10 million and he has it for like the next 50 years. I don't know, but it was an extreme branding bargain. And I don't think that anybody that negotiated that deal was very mindful of the long-term revenue effects that it had. It was an extreme bargain. Like I said, we could have done better. We could have got more for it. And if not, we should have even entered that deal with the renaming of the field. Thank you.
Well, contrary to what's been suggested, there's nothing easy about the Rose Bowl. I mean, the Rose Bowl does set us apart as a community, but it is surrounded by residential neighborhoods that do deserve to have a limit on major events, and that's been fought over for years in the city. It's subsidized by the golf course revenue, has been for a long time. Unfortunately, golf is declining. Larry Wilson is not enough to keep the golf course going. And so we've got sort of a perfect storm in terms of how to keep the Rose Bowl in the black. I think the RBOC has been very imaginative, and Victor deserves a lot of credit in terms of trying to come up with a formula, first with the music festival and now with a series of smaller events potentially, to try to ensure that the city does not have to increase its subsidy to the Rose Bowl. It means a lot to our city, but it's a major undertaking for a city of our size to have a world-class stadium like that, and it's a big challenge.
Thank you. Your brother, Mr. Williams.
So I just want to specify, when I say easy, you have to understand my particular background. Maybe their experience is not solving problems and figuring things out. For me, like I said at the beginning, it's something that makes me excited to actually go after that and solve those particular issues. So with me, the foundation of doing anything, you have to be able to say it's easy. If you approach everything as if it's the hardest thing in the world for you to do, then that negates you from the start. So that's what I mean when I say it's easy. But I know it's something that's very complex, and it's going to take a lot of creativity and a lot of work. It's going to take beyond what's ever in the capacity of my brain as well, too. I'm going to need help to be able to do that, those things that I'm talking about doing. Thank you.
Should African Americans and Latinos who were displaced during the 710 freeway land acquisition process have the first chance to buy, rent, or lease that property?
We'll let them answer. We'll start with you, Mr. Gordo.
So, we have to keep in mind that housing is regulated, housing laws are regulated by the federal government and the state and the Constitution. So practically speaking, I don't know that we could achieve should we create opportunities and provide incentives for minority communities? Absolutely. But and I'd be misleading you if I said to you that we can achieve something that I know is likely a violation of federal, state, and constitutional law.
Mr. Hardy.
Well, my short answer to that question would be yes, but it's deeper than that. I think that a lot of people who are here for the first time, they might be wondering why is this the oldest black church in Pasadena, and that's because it used to be a black neighborhood. You don't see traces of it anymore, but it used to be. And I think if we're going to do anything with that 7-10-7, a piece of it should be definitely be given back to the black community in the form of economic development, in the form of a black business district of Pasadena. If we're going to celebrate something, we just can't have a parade. If we're going to celebrate the people, the black people in the city, it's going to be through economic development. It can't just be a parade. The parade is beautiful, but it's not the end-all of how we should feel about our city and how we should feel about the black population. We need economic development, and mixed-use development and portion of that 710-7 would be a great way to do that. Thank you.
Mr. Tornik.
I think that the redevelopment of that 710-7 is one of the great opportunities that will face the city over the next probably 15 or 20 years. This is not a short-term project, but it's almost a magical project because it gets to knit back together a real scar in our community. And I think this suggestion is a winning suggestion. I would support it. I think that there are some legal challenges in terms of how we do priorities, but I think that the historical reality of what people were confronted with and the demolition associated with the 710 and the 210, for that matter, make it imperative that we make a stand and try to make something like that happen with the redevelopment of the 710 stub. Yes.
Yes. No, I'm so glad. So, of course, I spoke about this on other forums in regards to what should be done with the 710. Of course, I would want to reactivate the community and the ones who were actually displaced, the black and brown community. Because at this point, we have to make sure that we are morally in place in regards to our actions. Of course, there may also be legalities that are in place, but I truly like to focus on the things more so what we can do versus focusing on the things or saying what we can't actually do. And so I would support it if it was something that came across my desk as the next mayor, and I would be a champion and an advocate to make sure that we expedited that process beyond added incentives for our actual communities. But we also have to gauge if those community members are still here or if they have any interest to move in those particular areas. A lot of people have moved out. I've been doing a lot of talking to different communities, and they would say, you know, a lot of them, when they were displaced, moved to other states. And so that's, you know, that's a scenario as well. But we know we do have affordable housing that we can put there for the families that are here, that stayed here or remained here. Thanks.
Thank you. Since January 2019, almost 20 locally owned and operated restaurants have closed in Pasadena. This translates to a loss of as many as 1,000 jobs, as well as sales tax revenue and other losses. There are many factors that led to the closures, including high rents, competition, other expenses that limit profitability. But so far, none of these spaces have been filled with a restaurant or retailer. What would you do to stop further closures and encourage unique restaurants and retailers to open?
Mr. Hardy.
I appreciate that question. I think a lot can be done. The city does a good job at taxing these businesses. They, you know, we have the straw ban, and I believe in that, the styrofoam ban, and I believe in that. But these cost businesses, the rise in minimum wage, high rents, high sales taxes now, this cost businesses. But what the city doesn't do enough of is actually help businesses thrive despite the challenges that they have to face. You know, we have a lot of data collected from tourism and whatnot. We need to leverage that data and create workshops for our local businesses and entrepreneurs to teach them how to capitalize off the events and off the tourism that we have here. And if we supported our businesses, maybe they wouldn't close. Because I know that it's hard for everybody to stay here. But I think that if we do support them, empower them, teach them how to gain more customers, teach them how to tap into the brand power that is Pasadena. We have a worldwide known city. And there's no reason why the world should know the great businesses and organizations we have here. Thank you.
Pasadena has more restaurants per capita than all but one city in the United States. We have 592 restaurants at last count, and so it's not surprising that there are restaurants closing. In fact, there were more restaurants that opened last year than closed. So I think that the sort of postulate that we have a crisis because restaurants are closing is misplaced. And the single most important factor in restaurants closing is competition. What is true, and what I've talked with Paul Little at the Chamber of Commerce about, is that we're losing the sort of locally based restaurants and are being replaced by more formulaic, better funded national restaurants. And so the economic development folks in the city manager's office have been working closely with restaurateurs. I've met with restaurateurs to talk about how we can ease their burden. But I think you need to look at the whole marketplace and what's really happening in the space to understand what's happening.
I believe the reality of us having so many restaurants, it truly does rely on competition. I spoke with a lot of restaurant owners, whether it be the small mom-and-pop restaurants, and also some of the general managers of the chain restaurants that we have here. And the reality of it is evolution does happen, and that's why we're having some of the closures that are having, that are beginning to happen all over the city. And another reason why you're not seeing restaurants rush in, because we're not super business friendly in regards to our ordinances and the restrictions that we have here in the city. So if you combine those elements, you're going to have predicaments where you're driving by a shop that you really love or a cafe or a restaurant that you really love, yet that same building is still vacant 2 years later. I think it's going to take leadership to work with our local restaurant owners to let them know that, we want to provide additional services. My background is marketing, so I look forward for the challenge and opportunity to help them capture a new way of doing business so they can actually exist or, I don't want to say that. Thank you.
Mr. Gordon.
So I basically grew up in the restaurant industry. My father worked at the same restaurant for nearly 50 years, Ranchero's Mexican Restaurant. I waited tables at, I worked my way through school waiting tables at places like Roasting Diner. Sure, there's a natural attrition to the restaurant industry, but we shouldn't just be dismissive of concerns, very real concerns about competition to the east of us, the Americana, to the west of us in Arcadia. And we should work with our restaurateurs. I supported the minimum wage, and notwithstanding that, a lot of the restaurateurs that because it was the right thing to do, a lot of the restaurateurs that once supported another candidate last time around for mayor are now supporting me because I wasn't dismissive. I'm going to listen to them carefully. I think we should do a better job of coordinating our business districts, as an example. We should recognize some of the very real impacts around minimum wage, to-go containers, workers' compensation that our restaurants are feeling. We should do what we can. We should listen and do what we can to assist them.
Thank you. Mr. Farr?
Specifically, what is your plan as mayor to stimulate economic development and growth prosperity within the Northwest community?
Mr. Tornick, we're starting with you, Mr. Tornick.
From the time I came to Pasadena as planning director in 1982, the Northwest Pasadena has been a focus of my attention. And even after I left the city government, I worked in Pasadena Neighborhood Housing Services for 20 years to try to develop improved housing in Northwest. As mayor, I've continued to emphasize development activity in Northwest. I have worked with the city manager's economic development people. I participate in pitch meetings, talking to potential investors. We continue to look at some of the zoning issues. The Lincoln Avenue specific plan needs to be redone because it's not a realistic blueprint for the future development of that area. And I met over the past couple of weeks. I've been meeting with pastors in Northwest Pasadena to talk about both the use of their church land and other opportunities that may come our way in being able to develop, to stimulate economic development in Northwest Pasadena.
Mr. Williams.
So I really like this question simply because I've really been trying to find different way
ways to add more value from an economic standpoint, because as I've been saying on this campaign, when you focus on economics, it creates a ripple effect in regards to your actual community. Specifically with Northwest, that's kind of like why I came up with the ideal of, in my first 100 days, I would measure I and J, simply to subtract $1 million a year for the next 4 years to be able to use those excess funds to be able to revitalize our communities. As you know that we have this thing called community revitalization. I would like to create our own community revitalization act or plan here locally, and we have the funds that we can do it with already. We've already voted for it, something that's already existence. Measure I and J generates $21 million a year. $7 million, I believe, for the schools and the rest for the infrastructure. So if we created a program and said for 4 years we wanted to do $1 million, that could be economic a boost and increase for us to be able to use for an array of projects in the Northwest area. Thank you.
So an investment in Northwest Pasadena in the built infrastructure is important because it not only improves neighborhoods, but it also improves the business climate. And reinvesting in some of the properties in order to stimulate economic growth is one approach that I have taken personally on the city council. When we replace those liquor stores with affordable housing, it was the residents who were concerned about the liquor stores, but it was also the neighboring businesses who said, you know, it's difficult for us to operate when you have a nuisance activity that's run irresponsibly. And so we need to be more aggressive in looking at nuisance properties, improving nuisance properties in order to improve the business climate and improve the neighborhoods where people live. And so I intend to ensure that the city council makes the capital improvement investment in Northwest. I've demanded it in the past, and I think we should continue to do that.
Personally, I think a lot can be done to stimulate economic development in Northwest. I think there's a lot of buildings that are abandoned. There's a lot of places that we can use to redevelop. I'm a fan of mixed-use developments in the Northwest. Those are buildings with apartments and condos on top and stores on the bottom. We need more of those because we need more businesses. We need more jobs there. And like I said before, I do think the city needs to kind of create a business workshop, a workshop for businesses and entrepreneurs so they can actually become better at doing business in Pasadena. I think we need more subsidized licensing, permits, and vending opportunities. We need to have low and no-cost permits and vending opportunities for our folks in Northwest. And it's a lot to be done, but we do have to be mindful of the actions we have to take, and some of them are big, like I said, bringing mixed developments into Northwest, but also it's the will to see the local entrepreneurs and small businesses succeed. Thank you.
Last year, the city updated its affordable housing ordinance, requiring 20% of all units built to be affordable instead of 15%. Nearly doubling the in-lieu fee, which developers can pay instead of providing the affordable units outright. Would you favor eliminating the in-lieu fees and forcing developers to provide the housing upfront? Why or why not?
Starting with you, Ms. Williams. So, yes, I would support it, but I would only support it for a four-year term, simply so we can actually work with developers who would like to build 100% affordable housing or housing that's going to have a capacity of affordable housing as far as 20%. I really don't have an extended answer when it comes to that. You know, the in-lieu fees allow these developers to escape the opportunity for us to live in these apartments. And that's why we're in the predicament that we're in now. So, yes, I would support eliminating in-lieu fees. And the reason why I would do that is because we're in the predicament that we're in currently today. Thank you.
Because the only candidate who was on the city council when we pressed through the inclusionary housing ordinance, let me just remind us all, the purpose of the inclusionary housing ordinance was twofold. One, to develop more affordable housing, but to have it happen naturally as development occurred throughout the city. And so when we adopted that ordinance, I objected to the in-lieu fee because in my view, it defeated both goals. One, people could opt out. and they would pay a fee, and that fee never captured the cost of constructing an affordable housing unit, which is now over $550,000 for one unit. And so I objected to the fee then, and so I do think we should revisit it, because when people can opt out, then we don't get the affordable housing, we don't capture the actual cost of constructing it, and it's not occurring naturally with other projects as it happens, as they happen throughout the city. Now we're reverting back to what a lot of people said we shouldn't do in building it in the same parts of the city that we always have.
Thank you, Mr. Cordell. Mr. Harden.
Well, I'm personally proud of the effort that the city has made to raise the NOP as well as strengthen our inclusionary housing ordinance. I think it can continuously be stronger. It can continuously be increased in regards to the NOP. And I don't believe in eliminating it because I do believe that the choice still creates development. The choice incentivizes folks to actually want to build these units and want to actually build the units that are affordable. So I do believe we should raise it again. We should keep making it stronger. We should keep making the percentage more. We should have maybe shoot for 25%, maybe 30 next time. But to eliminate the NOP, I don't see a reason for more developers to want to develop in Pasadena and create any new units whatsoever if there's not at least an option or a choice. Thank you.
I think the NLUP is a valuable tool. I think the more flexibility we have, the better off we can respond to opportunities. The Salvation Army project that we're investing in, the funds for that will come from the NLUP. Being able to retain existing affordable housing, that's another opportunity that you can use the NLUP for. So I think while this is sort of a technical insider provision, now that we've raised the NLUP so there isn't an incentive for people to use it to get out of having to provide affordable housing, I think it's a valuable tool and we should keep it.
Mr. Farr?
As mayor, would you commit to using more public transportation at least once per week to better demonstrate and better understand how the system works from an experiential lens?
Start with Mr. Gordo.
Every week? You know, I do use public transportation, but I don't use it to go to work every day. I work in downtown Los Angeles, but my job requires that I have a vehicle to go to courthouses, to go meet with people that I represent throughout LA County, actually, and beyond. And so for me, it's not practical to use public transportation every day, but I would commit to using public transportation. And, well, actually, I do use it once I'm at my office, and if it's convenient to take either the bus or the red line to the blue line to downtown LA to the courthouse or one of the other courthouses. So I'm already doing it as part of my work in downtown Los Angeles.
Well, for me, that answer is easy, right? I almost took the bus here, so it would have been better because, like I said, the Uber drive almost made me late, so I think I would rather have taken the bus here. But just like I said, we can't have more public transportation if we don't use them, and if we don't use them, then it's no point in having them, and we have to lead by example. We can't encourage others to use them. We can't say we have all these great services that are available and the council that they use them. If we're going to lead a community, we have to lead by example. So that's what I think. Thank you.
I'm delighted with this question since Maria and I used public transportation yesterday and the day before. We went to Hollywood yesterday and we went downtown the day before. I would say I do use public transportation on average once a week. I wouldn't necessarily make a firm commitment to doing that on an ongoing basis, but I did run a regional transit authority. I grew up in New York, so I'm a transit user sort of genetically, and I am committed to public transportation.
I'm going to be honest with you. You know, me having kids, it makes it a lot more difficult to do a lot of public transportation because, you know, I do everything in unison with my family. A lot of times when people see me, they see me full throttle, even my wife's mom. So that makes it a little difficult. But, you know, I grew up on public transportation. Me and my oldest son, which is not here tonight, Carlo, we randomly just jump on a train. We go to Los Angeles and look at stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. But as far as making a certain commitment, I mean, I could, but let me be honest with you, Pasadena is so local, hyper-local, I literally walk to a lot of different places, you know, or ride my bike to certain places. But I support the transportation that we have here locally, no different than my mother supports planes, but she never would get on them. So, you know, everyone knows that. I'm sure everyone up here supports local transportation. I don't think you have to be an advocate riding every single day to know that you support something that you're advocating for as well. Thank you.
Time. Some citizens are very concerned about a perceived increase in Pasadena's traffic. Do you agree with this? And if so, or if not, what can you do to alleviate the problem?
Mr. Harden.
I do agree with it. I do think on-road transportation is not just a problem, but it's also the biggest contributor to greenhouse gas emissions in our city. Like I said, I'm an advocate, strong advocate for public transportation. And to get more on-road traffic off the road, I would advocate for more use of public transportation, but I would also incentivize it, too. There's a Lyft promo code. They partner up with Monrovia, and if you type Go Monrovia, you can travel anywhere within the city limits for a dollar. And if we did something like that in Pasadena, it would be a big help because we have a lot of special events that can really capitalize on that. I mean, people around the Rose Bowl wouldn't have to worry about parking and traffic around there so much. And as well as they get a lot of cars off the street. So I think we have to incentivize the use of alternative transportation, but we also have to bring back our electric scooters. I think they can do a lot if we try to make them more safer, if we introduce them to the community properly, if we have some designated places they should be and not just thrown on every corner. But, yeah, we need to do a lot more to kind of get folks out of their cars and into public transportation or alternative modes of transportation, such as bikes and scooters and such. Thank you.
The reports from the Department of Transportation suggest, because they monitor the corridors, both east-west and north-south across the city, that the travel times have really not increased very much. The traffic is not as bad as people think it is, but you can't convince anybody of that in rush hour. If you try to go on California Boulevard at 5:15, you're going to have a problem. So we will continue to try to induce people to get out of their cars. But beyond that, we are making transportation improvements. We need to have smarter signals. We need to have continued intersection improvements. We've got money from the 710 freeway transfer that will allow us to grade separate the Gold Line at California Boulevard. And so I think we will continue to upgrade our street network so the traffic can move more freely. But the real solution is to try to get people to travel in off-peak if they can and to achieve a better housing jobs balance so that fewer people have to commute in and out of the city.
I must admit, this is a subject where it kind of caught me off guard as I've been campaigning, walking around when people are talking about traffic. You know, given the fact that I kind of work from home and work from my computer, I'm a little oblivious to it. And so you can imagine my dismay when so many people were bringing this up. And, you know, and they just had a certain displeasure traveling around the city. But as I've been hearing from different sides, everyone doesn't feel that way. It does depend on the times that you're actually traveling here in the city. But to mediate that, we'll come in regards to the upgrades that are happening with our transportation system. And just understanding what's available for them and understanding the pickup points and the drop-off points and make sure they have all that particular information. One of the ways in regards to transportation, which I'll talk about on my outro, I'm looking forward to, so I won't share it now. But traffic isn't as big of an issue as a lot of people think it is. It just really depends on what time you're traveling throughout the day.
Thank you.
Mr. Farr?
Mr. Farr?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, did I jump over your head?
No. So development and traffic
come hand in hand. And if it feels to you like developers have the upper hand, they do. They have the upper hand in Sacramento, and they have the upper hand in Pasadena, and I'm concerned about that. And, you know, this traffic issue is real. It's not just, you know, some chart. We feel it. If it feels to you like the fabric of the city is changing, it is, both in what we're constructing and the impacts of it. And part of the reason traffic has increased is because we are not measuring the cumulative impacts locally. We're measuring them citywide of new development, and that's wrong. That's why you've seen me vote no on a number of projects. In East Pasadena at Space Bank, we weren't measuring the cumulative impacts of all that development that was occurring. And if we're not measuring it, we're not mitigating it. And I pressed and pressed and pressed to change that. Finally, last week, other people on the council started agreeing that we should be measuring the cumulative impacts of traffic and mitigating for them.
I think it's important to realize that the connection between new development and traffic is oversimplified. If you go to some of these new developments, as I have, you'll find that they have a lot of vacant parking in some of these new developments. The people that are moving into these new developments are not necessarily two cars per unit. Some of them have one car, some of them have no cars. Their lifestyle is not the same as the typical suburban lifestyle that we're used to in Pasadena. So to connect the dots and suggest that new development is what's creating the new traffic, I think, is misleading. And in fact, the more people that live and work in Pasadena, that subtracts traffic from the inventory rather than adding to it. And I think we have to have a more nuanced understanding of the relationship between development and traffic.
Thank you. I didn't miss anybody this time, did I? Mr. Farr.
As mayor, how will you ensure local hiring on public and private construction in Pasadena is facilitated, will be facilitated?
We're starting with Mr. Twain.
We've done a lot better on some projects than others in terms of local hiring. And I think, for example, Heritage Square North did a great job. The Lincoln Properties project in Old Pasadena, not a great job. I think we have to be careful in terms of abiding by the law and not establishing quotas, but we also have to be more sophisticated in terms of how we see these jobs broken up so they're done in pieces that small contractors, local contractors that hire local people can participate in. And that's true for city activities as well. We've sent back to staff several contracts to have them rethink how the contracts are being bid so that smaller contractors who do local hiring and minority hiring can participate and are not excluded. And we're doing that in terms of several contracts that we're taking up right now, including custodial services in the city.
As the next mayor, I would just make sure that my intent, working with different developers that are bringing projects to the table, to make sure that the intent is there. Whether you can make it manifest or make it happen or not, the intent has to be there. You have to be able to bring that up, and you have to be able to advocate and push for that and make sure that this council is in unison pushing that narrative. But more importantly, it's important that we had a project. I just saw a post on Parsons Development. I think the city's done a good job in regards to soliciting anyone to come for a job fair that they have for Parsons. They started doing hiring locally here. I think that could be a good measuring bar and something that we can actually use for future developers who come into our city to know how they should interact with us in regards to development moving forward. Thank you.
Mr. Gordon.
So we recently received a report from the group that's redeveloping Parsons, and it was a dismal report. And people expressed shock, awe, and concern. I did not. I knew that their local hire was not going to work. When that project came forward, I insisted that we put the local hiring provisions in writing. And I said, if it doesn't happen in writing, it's not going to happen, and that's what we've seen now. And, you know, part of it, well, putting it in writing is understanding how the labor market works. On these large projects, they're usually large union contractors. And unions can't hire locally because federal law mandates that they follow a list.
So when you enter into a community benefits agreement that allows the unions to not follow the list and hire people locally, we've said that before. We need to get serious about local hire, and that's the way we're going to do it. Thank you.
Mr. Harden.
First off, I believe the city should always do its best in trying to find local companies to fulfill any contract they have. When that's not possible, I do believe that Mayor Cornett is right in breaking down bigger jobs into micro contracts. I do believe that cleanup and certain things like demolition or post cleanup can actually be done by a lot of local custodial companies, a lot of local contractors. But in addition, I think that we can kind of at least explore or consider maybe an inclusionary employment ordinance where when somebody comes into our community, they are forced in some way to hire locally. And if they can't, then they can go with who they were going to bring in anyway. Thank you.
All right. Last question, guys. What is the most distinct thing about Pasadena, and how do you aim to sustain it? What is the most distinct thing about Pasadena?
For me personally, I've only been here 9 years, but I feel like the evolution of inclusion has been something that's been something I had to learn how to navigate, because this is kind of like a town that tells you, what have you done for me lately? And I've actually looked at it as a challenge and an opportunity to earn my way here in the city. And so for the last 4 years, I've been working with my nonprofit, working with different kids in the community, working with different leaders in the community. But more importantly, just being an open ear, listening to everyone that I've been talking to every single day. And I think that's one of the great characteristics of this city. They will allow you at some point in capacity to earn their trust, earn their support. And what I'm hoping for moving forward, earn your vote on March 3rd. Thank you.
So I believe Pasadena is the center of the universe, and it's the center of the universe. People come here because of the Rose Bowl, the Arroyo, food, architecture, but they stay because of the people. And so I believe that the diversity of our city is important. I believe that what makes us so special is our sense of place, and that means protecting the fabric of our city, protecting neighborhoods, protecting diversity, because it's our neighborhoods, it's the people that live in those neighborhoods, and the diversity that we've enjoyed that we need to protect in order to maintain that sense of place. And so I'm committed to doing both of those things.
Mr. Harden.
Well, there's a lot of things that make this city unique and distinct. And, we have beautiful landscapes. We have beautiful structures and beautiful neighborhoods. We have trees. We have wildlife. We have hiking trails. We have waterfalls. We have everything in Pasadena. But what makes me love it so much is the people, And that's what I want to preserve. I want to preserve the people more than anything else. And how I do that, even now, is by getting involved. And to be honest, I don't think we have another 4 years to wait, because my people that live in my community, they're leaving. In another 4 years, the population is going to be down even more so. So this is very important to me. So I try to get involved, and I urge other people to get involved in decision-making practices of our city so that we can create the policies necessary to keep us in the community, because that's my concern. Thank you.
I think what's remarkable about Pasadena is that we play so much bigger than we are. We have a footprint that's really international, even though we're a small city. And that's because we honor our past, and at the same time, we can be creative and have a vision for the future. Pasadena has understood for a long time that you can't freeze the place in amber, and while you can continue to preserve what's important, like old Pasadena, you have to make changes that allow it to be successful in the future. And so I think in terms of maintaining our diversity in housing types, in population, in all kinds of ways. The way we do that is being able to grab a hold of change, not fear it, but try to accommodate it and shape it in a way that benefits our city.
I think that's it for the questions.
Okay,
maybe
good.
Move to...
Well, here's what we'll move to. I'm sorry, I was writing. What happened here, you guys moved pretty quickly, and so I had to ad-lib some of this stuff at the end. I went, whoa, you guys did a good job. We kept it brief. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to give each candidate 1 minute for a closing statement. 1 minute for a closing statement. We'll start with you, Mr. Gordo.
So, my name is Victor Gordo, and it's humbling to me to even stand before you and ask for your support for mayor. Given my life's history and experience, and I'm honored to do that. I've dedicated my life's work since I was 18 years old to improving Pasadena for the people of Pasadena. You've watched me serve as a field representative. You've watched me work in a summer youth employment program, putting kids to work. You've watched me work at day one, bringing kids together for better opportunities. And you've watched me as a member of the city council work to improve conditions in our city. As your mayor, I believe I'm best positioned to bring this city together to work as one. Whether it's East Pasadena, West Pasadena, Southwest Pasadena, Northwest Pasadena, I believe I have the trust of people who live in all of these neighborhoods. And I commit to you that I will work to ensure that that this city is working together to solve complex and difficult issues. Thank you.
Mr. Harden.
I just wanted to say that I'm not running for mayor because it'll look good on my resume. I don't like public speaking. There's a lot of parts of this that I really don't enjoy. But to be honest, I'm up here because I feel I have to be up here. I feel nobody up here represents what I care about. Nobody up here connects to me and my community. And if I'm not here, who would be? So that's my reason for being up here. You know, I'm not here to run for the mayor to represent the city of Pasadena. I'm here to run to represent the people of Pasadena. And if you guys give me a chance, I know I can make changes happen quickly. I'm young. I have the energy. I showed what I can do on the council, or at least on the commission, and I want to bring that to council. And if anybody wants a yard sign, I have them. If anybody wants to replace the ones you have, I have them. Thank you.
Mr. Dorian.
Well, thank you all for hanging in. I mean, we've answered, by my count, 21 questions, and I don't see anybody dozing, so I'm impressed. It shows the level of commitment that people have to this city. And I've learned that in my almost 40 years in Pasadena by visiting places like this. The last time I was here was for a prayer breakfast, and every table around the breakfast prayed for me, and that was an experience that I enjoyed very much and can make use of. I hope that over the past 5 years I've demonstrated that I care deeply about Pasadena and that I've done a lot to preserve what's wonderful about Pasadena. But I also have a vision for the future of Pasadena, which I hope has come through to you tonight. Pasadena can continue to play above its size, to be a diverse city, to be financially strong, safeguard its neighborhoods, and pursue sustainable progress. And I hope that on March 3rd you'll give me an opportunity to continue that work. Thank you very much.
Mr. Williams.
Thank you. I'm thankful to be on this platform to be able to share in front of you all today. What I would like to do in close is just share what my first 100 days in office as mayor will look like. I will introduce financial literacy, wealth creation, and credit repair programs at the Jackie Robinson Recreation Center. I will also present an amendment to Measure I and J, which will propose a $21 million, repurpose $21 million and allocate $1 million per year for those funds for the next 4 years. Those funds will be reserved for special economic hardships within our communities, for women that are subject to domestic violence, and funding source for unjust rental evictions. Third, I will present a real-time digital dashboard that will display the city budget and the allocation of our funds. So, for the first time in history, Pasadena officials can champion real transparency or continue to keep the can down the road, so to speak, as to what I'm proposing is impossible. It has been said that Mayor is an extension of former Mayor of 16 years, Bill Bogart, and Victor Gordo is also an extension of Mr. Bogart, hence his endorsement. Yet, some seem to believe the only candidates eligible to lead our city are the same individuals in our city. I look forward to earning your vote March 3rd, Pasadena. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. No, 1 minute. I want to this was our last question. I want us to thank all the candidates for being here and hanging in. This was a long amount of questions. Briefly, I want to thank the Star News, also Mr. Bradley Vermont and James Farr, for being here, and for the pastor who allowed us to use the church. We will have a short meet and greet next door. I invite you all to stay. Hopefully all the candidates are not tired of us yet and want to talk to us a little more. And so we'll see you next door. Thank you all for coming out.
Noe on the spot.